Good morning, everybody. This is the Personal Playlist Podcast, fondly referred to as the P3, on VoiceEd Radio. I'm Noah Daniel. I am so excited to welcome Janelle McLaughlin here to the Personal Playlist Podcast, my 50th episode. Janelle is an education strategist, consultant, presenter, coach, keynote speaker, and trainer. Over the years, she's been a classroom teacher and a district administrator. Today, Janelle is also an entrepreneur, author, a social media strategist, and a tech enthusiast. These passions and experiences led her to begin her own company, Innovative Education Solutions. She gets to travel all over and utilize her teaching talents by working with leaders at all levels to make their jobs easier and more efficient while focusing on the people. Some of her specialties include leadership development, student-driven instruction, blended learning, one-to-one implementation, effective technology integration, G Street, Chromebooks, Office 365, process management, and organizational leadership. I am so excited to welcome Janelle McLaughlin here to the show. Hi, Janelle.
Hi, Noah. Thanks so much. And how exciting to be on the 50th episode.
I'm excited that you're here. For a long time, I've been, you know, looking at the work that you do and the inspirational quotes that you put onto LinkedIn that I often will share out, because not only are you doing the strategy, but you have strategy behind some of these beautiful visions that you share, and then you implement them with different people. Are you enjoying the experience of traveling so much?
You know, I absolutely love the work, and the travel is like not as glamorous as most people think it is. So that's actually a little bit of a downside to the work, but I love the job and I love the work that I get to do with such a vast variety of people. So the travel is just part of it.
I think that your company name is so perfect, considering that you're not just using innovation from an ed tech standpoint, but you really are working collaboratively to come up with different ways of doing things. And, you know, student-driven instruction is really my sweet spot. And I love when I see one-to-one implementation somewhere after student-driven, I think technology, but I also think really going one-to-one with learners.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. And my focus is always on the instructional strategy. Some teachers I work with don't really know what they're signing up with or signing up for until they get into it with me. And they think that it's just going to be learning some new tools and digital resources. And while I definitely point them towards some, the focus is always on the pedagogy behind it. And nobody's ever disappointed, but that's not always what they think that they're getting when they come on board.
Okay, well, it's good that in the end they're excited to use what they've learned. And that's really what the role of having a consultant come in to do, is to be able to take big ideas, to take pedagogy, and to be able to blend them together into actionable things where you walk away with more than just a morsel, but really a shift in how you do things.
Absolutely. And I'm very grateful every time school districts hire me to come in, because, I mean, one, obviously I'm grateful because it's work, but I'm grateful when they buy into the bigger vision of, I'm just a huge proponent in ongoing professional development. And too often districts will buy devices because one-to-one implementation is the thing to do, but then they don't provide the professional development and growth plan for all of their educators in order for it to be effective. And so most of what I do is job-embedded coaching, where I get to work one-on-one with teachers and administrators, and that's where the big shifts happen. I love an inspirational keynote as much as the next person, and it has its place, but I think the deep hard work happens in the classrooms and in the offices of the school buildings.
Yeah, especially, you know, some of the times I'll look really deeply at the photographs that you take capturing the learning. And I love that the administration is working with their staff together, because that's really how you make those cultural shifts mm-hmm. when you're implementing new ideas.
It's key. I absolutely agree with you. And I've definitely worked in districts where the administrators are more hands-off, but the ones that are the most successful, those principals, the curriculum directors, the technology department, they're side by side with their teachers. Makes a huge difference.
Yeah. And that whole lead learner idea of being there to not just co-learn, but to evolve along mm-hmm. with your staff. I think that is so significant. And in many ways, we evolve together over the half hour of this show, because people bring me a nostalgic song, a song that reflects their identity, and a song that is inspirational. motivational. And I think that the experience is a lot like the process of doing consulting in that it's not an easy one-off. So what was your experience in preparing for the Personal Playlist podcast?
Well, first, Noah, I was so honored when you even asked me to be a guest because, like you, I've been watching the work that you've done on social media over the last few years. I actually wrote about it in a blog post today that we've never met in real life, but I've been watching what you do and learning from you over the last few years. So that alone was a huge honor to me. I will say the song selection part was definitely a growth point for me. And I'm big in reflective practice, and I feel like you really made me reflect a lot on this. It was hard, which I know from listening to previous episodes, other people have said the same thing. It was hard, not necessarily to narrow it, but for me to be really intentional about the songs that I chose. I love music. My family loves music, but my kids will be the first ones to tell you that I do not listen closely to lyrics most of the time. I will be jamming out in the car and they're like, "Mom, this song's so inappropriate." then I have to change it real fast. Anyway, I took what I did to narrow my three choices is I took some songs that really did mean a lot to me, and I had a whole list of them, and I had to listen to them while reading the lyrics to make sure that I wasn't misinterpreting the song in some way, and then narrowed it down to the three that I thought really spoke to each of the areas that you asked me to pick from.
Okay, well, let's get to your nostalgic song then, because it's a song that tells a story as a lyric and as music itself. So I'm inferring that tells a piece of your story. So tell us a little bit about that.
Well, I was born in a small town and I was raised in that small town. I still live in that small town. And I love the town where I live. And I moved away for college and got married shortly after college. And we stayed away for a couple years, but I knew it was always my goal to be back here close to my family in order to raise my family. And so that also, I live in Indiana. So to pick a John Mellencamp song was kind of important too, just because he's a hometown guy. There are parts to the song that definitely don't apply to my life, but in general, this song always makes me think of just where I live and where I've grown up.
It's amazing that you came back to raise your children in that place. It says a lot. Like, I think it's so special. And especially in those small towns, there is a different experience. And to be able to give that to your children, sometimes I really lament the loss of being able to be out on the street and feeling so safe and my parents not knowing where I was until the lights were really, really dark. And it was just a wonderful life. Mm-hmm. And it's so cool that you're giving your children that.
Thanks. There are pros and cons, you know, just like with everywhere you live, but I'm hoping the pros outweigh the cons.
Okay, well, let's enjoy this song together. Your nostalgic song, John Mellencamp, Small Town.
Educated in a small town, taught to fear Jesus.
get this imagery of the reality, just like you said, of the good and bad of small town life, but there is something distinct and special about it. So intrigued to find out why this is your identity song. So I really want to know how this American pop rap duo became the singers of this song that really tells your story.
So this is a song that I just currently really like. Every time it comes on, I'm singing along, I'm smiling, I'm kind of dancing. And in general, I just have a super optimistic outlook on life. I'm a very positive person in general. And so a lot of what the song talks about resonates with me as far as like, I'm just going to keep rising. And I think it kind of goes back to the downsides of that small town where, I taught in this town and I was the curriculum director of our town and I loved it. And I probably thought I would be there forever until I just had a difficult work relationship experience. Just my boss was just not a good person. and it made me reevaluate what's next. And, I left a job that I loved and left a district that had been my home for a lot of years, kind of not knowing what I was going to do next. Because I just needed to get away from like the toxic environment. And here 4 years later, I've built a really successful business doing something that I absolutely love and believe in. And so it just makes me, this song just resonates with me as far as I'm just going to keep rising. And we're always going to have things that kind of try to pull us down through out of light, like just different things through life. And that's not going to stop me.
You know, I had a very similar experience. I had never set out to build a building outside the blocks business. And it's funny because I reached out to you and said at some point, although I never actually followed up, that I wanted to learn more about consulting. And I can't believe that that's your story. Did you know that you wanted to become a consultant, or you kind of made lemonade from the whole scenario?
Well, I was contemplating so I never wanted to be a building level principal. And that seemed like what my option was when I left curriculum director, because of where I live, there aren't lots of corporations. I mean, I just live in a small town, so I'm going to have to drive a long ways to get anywhere. So there weren't a lot of administrator jobs. And I just was thinking back about all of the things that I loved about being a curriculum director. And the part that I loved the most was creating, developing, organizing professional learning experiences for the teachers that I worked with. And so that just seemed to lend itself well to consulting. And so I started reaching out to people that were consultants to try to figure out how people did this work. And I connected with the right people at the right time that helped me start that business by providing steady work for me. So that was kind of probably a combination of what you said. Like, I knew that I loved doing this kind of work, but I also made lemons out of lemonade at the point of where I was.
Very cool. Okay, well, here's your identity song, Jack and Jack, Rise, featuring Jonas Blue.
We're gonna rise, 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 rise till we fall. They say we got no future at all. They wanna keep us out, can't hold us down anymore. We're gonna rise, 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 rise till we fall. When we hit the bottom, we got language, they say we're too savage.
is that an awesome song.
Isn't that fun?
I mean, it is fun. Man, that music and everything that you said, I mean, good for you. Good for you that you are that person that's always able to rise to your fall. I think that that is, it's a wonderful model for so many of us.
Thank you. And I have two children. My daughter is almost 16 years old, and it's important to me to just model what being a strong professional woman looks like to her. And I think I'm doing that.
No, I think, you know, when you have children, it is important to simultaneously live your life and show that you have your own life, but also to model for them how they can live theirs. And sometimes it's only modeling it by your mistakes and how you pick yourself up again. And if that's the only message that they get, that you have to be tenacious and you have to keep on going and keep rising, if that's what it takes, then that's a good message too. But it's a very bizarre thing to be a parent and still be struggling through life sometimes and living. I mean, you still have to wake up and you still have to be for them and you still need to be for you. And it can be a very challenging thing to do that. So, you know, it's good that we have music to remind us of what we're capable of. And sometimes sharing those moments with your kids and singing along can be so special and so fun. Is this a song that your daughter likes also?
She does somewhat. She's a teenage girl and she's just really into her own kind of music, which is more along the rap line. So we share some common music that we like, but not too many. She does like this song, but we definitely have some.
It's getting harder for me. My grade eights are about to start doing their personal playlist projects. And every year that I've done it, I've had to say, you know, here are my parameters, no extraneous swearing. And a lot of kids are like, well, then there's nothing I can play, Mrs. Daniel. And it's a funny thing because you want to give them a space to do their own thing and to share what really matters to them. But you also have to remind them of audience, which can be, it can be trying at times. But your inspirational song is a song that really is about not being afraid. And it has a lot of deep meaning. So tell us a little bit about this choice and when you like to listen to this song.
So I like a huge range of genres of music. And contemporary Christian is definitely a genre that I like to listen to as well. And this is I first heard it on the Message radio station that I listen to sometimes. And loved the song, but really it was more when I started thinking about it more for this podcast that I realized how much it is kind of a motto for what I believe in. And I'm a big believer that everybody needs a coach. And so I actually am working on a project with a gentleman who offered to do some coaching with me. And one of the things he asked me is, what stories do you tell yourself that affect how you live? And that was a hard question for me. I'm like, I don't really, like, I'm a confident person. I don't really have negative self-talk. And in general, I don't, but it definitely creeps in every once in a while, just now that I've been more aware. And it's that fear, you know, that fear of something. That's where all negative self-talk comes from, is some type of fear. And I am choosing not to believe what any of that is. I'm just going to keep doing what I know is best for the people I impact and for myself, and not listen to the lies that try to come from society.
It's interesting. It actually comes from the New Testament. So 2 Timothy 1:17. Sorry, I'm an Old Testament person. So is that the correct way to read it?
2 Timothy, but pretty close. Yeah.
Second. Thank you. See, yeah. Okay, I was close, but thank you. I appreciate that. Sure. And it says, for God has not given you a spirit of fear, but of power, love, and a sound mind. And I think that your point about fear and fear being the root of the negative self-talk, I think it's a truthful example of something we have to face if we want to let go and if we want to inspire ourselves to be our best selves. But it's hard to work through sometimes. And even the artist, Zach Williams, was saying, you know, that idea of you have nothing to fear but fear itself, is that fear isn't fact. And often we treat it as if it's fact. And when you're a positive person like you are, you can work it through a little bit easier, but it can be really difficult. So this song, I'm assuming from the title, Fear is a Liar, is about facing that fear.
Mm-hmm. Yes, exactly. And just not listening to whatever that fear is trying to tell you.
I think the other part that's interesting about that is saying, recognizing the fear. You know, a lot of us, we push down, we repress fear because we're afraid of it. And so it sits there and then it manifests and it gets worse, or it comes out in odd ways. And if you can name it and you can face it and you can say you have no power to this fear, then it can't control you. Yeah, it's a really important message. Let's hear the song. Mm-hmm. And one of the things I love so much about this show is I learn so many things about so many things. And when people bring on genres that I haven't had or songs that I haven't listened to, adding the musical dimension, I love this show. And I'm so happy that you're here. Okay, here's Zach Williams, Fear is a Liar.
Told you you're not good enough, when he told you you're not right, when he told you you're not strong enough to put up a good fight, when he told you you're not worthy, when he told you you're not loved, when he told you you're not beautiful, you'll never be enough.
Personification of fear too in that song. It almost made me think about my situation that I related to your situation. You know, there are so many people that sadly want to make you feel not good enough and not strong enough and not loved or not beautiful. And it can be really hard, and facing that fear, it's a wild animal. But if songs like this can give you the power to say, yeah, what I'm afraid of isn't real. And I can lessen the intensity of that feeling, because just because they say it doesn't mean it's true. That's something I wish we could give all teenagers today with all of the things that they're dealing with in social media. I mean, I do not envy them. I've said it so many times. They're inundated with fears because of the pressures that they're dealing with. So songs like this can really help people diminish the power that fear can hold over you.
Absolutely.
It's a really beautiful song, this inspirational song choice of yours.
Thank you. I love it. And I'm just listening to it as you played it, it puts me in kind of a different place too. When you first asked me like a pick me up or an inspirational song, I'm thinking of more something upbeat. But this is the one that I kept coming back to. So maybe not a pick me up so much as an inspirational.
Yeah, but that's exactly why there are so many descriptors for that song, is because it should be as personal as possible. And it's amazing when the universe kind of helps you and keeps pushing you back to a song. Like there is something magical about this process. So Janelle, we went through all three songs. How are you feeling?
I just feel happy. Those are my great songs. So it makes me happy to sit and listen to them. And it took me from like exactly through the path that I'm sure you intend, but you know, this reminiscing to this happy place with the identity to just this serene, like strength with my inspirational song at the end. Now I've got to go figure out some work to do because I'm all ready to do it.
Isn't that wonderful? Well, you can find Janelle's work at innovativeeducationsolutions.net. You can reach out to her on Twitter at Ms. Mac 4. I actually never noticed that was your Twitter handle. I guess I've been following you for so long. I never noticed. So it's at Ms_Mac4. That'll be on the blog post. And of course on LinkedIn, where she's full of inspiration, constantly posting wonderful things about her work and quotes. Is there anything else that people should know in order to find you?
No, that's great. That's great. No, I'm of course on Facebook and Instagram as well, but most of my professional work is on LinkedIn and Twitter. And I love connecting and collaborating with people. That's probably my favorite thing about the work I do, is just how I learn from other people and the relationships I get to build. So always excited to make new connections.
I am really happy that we made this connection. For so, so long, you've been a person that I've interacted with, but now actually speaking to you and adding dimension to it, I'm really excited to continue learning from you and to share your P3 with everybody. I don't know if you know, but I write a blog post about every person. So it's like this wonderful joy. I get to sit with you for the next week and listen to the show and try to quote you as much as possible. So I just, again, at the 50th recording of the Personal Playlist podcast, I want to thank you so much for coming out, for going through this process. I hope it was everything that you said it was. So yay. Is there anything you want to say before I play you out?
No, just thank you so much for the opportunity, Noah, and absolutely, let's keep talking.
Okay, fantastic. Have a great day.
Thanks, you too.
Thank you for joining us on the P3, the Personal Playlist podcast. I'm Noah Daniel. This is Voice Ed Radio, and I hope you have a fantastic day.